is a professor of applied soil ecology at the University of Manitoba. His training includes a Bachelor of Science in Botany, Physical Geography, and a Master's in Soil Science, a PhD in Plant Science, and a postdoctoral research in nematology. From 2006 to 2016, Mario served as Canadian Research Chair in Applied Soil Ecology. Mario currently leads the Soil Ecology Laboratory at the University of Manitoba, where they tackle questions and issues that help provide farmers and the ag industry with solutions to the big questions on how to increase the profitability while improving the soil and environmental health. Mario and his team have addressed many soil-related issues, including how to improve nitrogen use efficiency, documentation of the benefits of the 4R nutrient management practices, development of rapid molecular tests and field surveys of emerging soil-borne diseases and nematode crop pests, and the sustainability of Canadian prairie crop production system. Join me in welcoming Dr. Mario Tenuta.
Great. Thank you. Whoa, this is, I talk loud, so I'm going to probably have to stand back here, or else I'm going to be like a Mac, one of those old Maxell cassette tape commercials with the guy's hair blowing back there and stuff like that. Mike, can you hit the presentation, sir? That's going to be it for the Star Wars theme on the presentation. Trust me, I could get really carried away with that. So, 4R nutrient management, I feel as if I'm really loud. Am I really loud? No? Okay, good. I can get closer? Okay, excellent. So, the presentation is going to be in two parts. The first is me talking to you like a conventional seminar, lecture, persecution, whatever you want to call it. And then the second part is your chance to participate with a survey. So I'm going to need you to have your phones, okay? Have your phones, your smartphones, and rotary dial phone won't work for this. We need a smartphone, okay? And so that'll be about into 35 minutes in, okay? Okay. So, we have a looming crisis. It's a crisis in agriculture, and it's related with nitrogen, and particularly with nitrogen fertilizer. And I call it a crisis because it really is. We're seeing a change, and it's going to happen next few years, within the next decade. Probably going to happen very rapidly. It's probably going to take us quite by surprise. So let's look at some of these challenges that we face. This first one here is about 2% of the world's greenhouse gas emissions is from the production of fertilizers. So this is a Koch fertilizer plant in Brandon, Manitoba, just 2 hours down the road from me. And all that steam you see is because of the heat and the natural gas that is being used to produce that heat and pressure. And that's 2%. You might say that's not much, but that is quite a bit because it's a single industry that is doing that. That's about equivalent to what world shipping does in terms of ocean shipping of of goods across the ocean. So it's pretty significant. So there's that challenge we have. The next is this, in terms of a greenhouse gas that is produced anytime nitrogen is added to soil. And it could be fertilizer nitrogen, but it also could be manure, and it also could be plant residue nitrogen as well. So even from plow downs of plants. Anytime we add nitrogen, we can get N2O produced, and that's nitrous oxide, and it's a very potent greenhouse gas. Now, for Canada, depending on which way you count it and stuff like that, it's 5.3% of all the greenhouse gases produced by human activities is N2O, in terms of its contribution to the warming potential from Canada to the global environment. Doesn't sound like much, but if we break it down, to where that N2O is coming from, you can see almost half of it is coming from the use of nitrogen fertilizers. And then there's manure, but the animals are getting the nitrogen that they're pooping out to cause the emissions. They're getting it from fertilizer often, right? And then there's crop residue. So if you actually add up everything that's linked with fertilizers, it's about 3/4 of the N2O emissions, okay? And this is a bit of a target for us, because policymakers can say, well, we need to reduce methane, CO2, and N2O. Agriculture is the source for N2O. They'll need to contribute just like the other industries in economic sectors, okay? That's going to be happening down the pipes. Right now, we're very high-hanging fruit. So we're going after low-hanging fruit like transportation emissions and things like that. But at some point, as we strive to get to neutrality, the pressure is going to really hit us, okay? So that's number two. This talk is not supposed to be pessimistic, by the way, okay? So trust me, okay? I'm not about gloom and doom. I like solutions. Another one is this, and this is in the U.S. You know, in the U.S., they like to litigate everything, right? Take you to court, and stuff like that. Well, there's many jurisdictions that the cities and municipalities are taking the countryside, so the counties and so forth around them, to court, because they have to remove the nitrate that's in the water, process it out, so that they can then give safe drinking water to their customers. And it costs them a lot of money to do that. And so they can point out that it's the farms that are contributing to that nitrate in the groundwater. So we've had several cases of this in the U.S., and there are several more that are still in the courts, okay? And so this is probably not going to stop, as can probably the urban to rural conflict in this is going to be quite important for the future. And it's kind of like with phosphorus, going to lakes and things like that. But in this case, it's to the groundwater and with nitrate. The fourth is ammonia volatilization. We don't really think of this one. It's very important, actually. It was about 20 years ago, the Ecological Society of America put a task force together, and they said, what is the number one concern for the environment that humans do? And they came to the conclusion it was nitrogen addition as ammonia to the atmosphere, because it falls down somewhere, and it's going to fall down in oceans or in forests, and it fertilizes those areas that don't really get much nitrogen, right? It's not that much. It could be about 10 pounds of N per acre. But in some areas in Europe, such as in the Netherlands and so forth, we can be talking 50 to 100 pounds of nitrogen that is free from the atmosphere, where you can't fertilize. It's against the law, because there's enough nitrogen raining down because of all the livestock production and various other things like that. And this is a map done by Environment Canada from colleagues in Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada. And the red areas are where there's lots of ammonia emissions. And it's also associated with urban areas too, as you can see, for the cities. But you can see the ag areas are yellow or red. Okay. And so this is another reason pointing out about nitrogen use in farmland. And more recently, this made a big splash where some pretty smart people got together from around the world and started saying, looking at the global environment and trying to assess its state and the human activities and how they may affect the globe. And they broke it up into different activities and keep trigger points, if you want to call it, on the Earth. And these are the different points here. I want to point out two of them. The big ones with the red slices. See how those red slices go past the edge of the Earth? That means we've gone past the point of where it's healthy for the environment. It's actually almost a point of no return of the impact of what's happened there. So it's biodiversity loss, so urbanization and clearing natural areas, and the other red one on the right is nitrogen use. Okay, other things like climate change don't register as having reached the edge of the Earth yet. Okay, we hear about climate change all the time, but we don't hear about the nitrogen use ones. But the people that are thinking at a global level, it's on their radar. Okay. The other is, this is for Manitoba, just taking canola and grain corn. Fertilizer, and it's mostly nitrogen fertilizer, is the largest operating cost of your farms, right? And it's always a challenge, you know, it's in the prairies anyway, it's gotten a bigger and bigger slice of the operating costs over time, especially as our rates of nitrogen are going up, okay? So you're trying to make profits and squeeze everything you can, you're going to be looking at what you can be doing with your number one operating costs and trying to reduce it and getting the most out of it in terms of yield. Also, just 32% for canola, 28% for corn in terms of fertilizer operating costs for Manitoba. That's pretty significant. The other is, again, this is for Manitoba, but it's probably similar for most crops in Ontario. Maybe grain corn would be slightly different. It's probably leveled off in terms of nitrogen addition. But often we see as the yields, we always have steady yield increases because we have new genetics and new practices. And so we always have this new potential for yield. But you're not going to realize that yield without proper nutrition, right? So our rates of fertilizers, particularly nitrogen, are often going up, creeping up over time. So in Manitoba, it's more than a pound per acre of N for hard red canola and grain corn, okay? So I'm showing you the things about there's some issues with nitrogen here, but we're dependent, our system is dependent on using more nitrogen over time, okay? So it's an opposite trajectory, and that's a problem, okay? So here are some of the responses that we're starting to see. The litigation I mentioned, carbon taxes, in terms of fuels for producing fertilizers. At the moment, carbon credits, yes, there's potential for carbon sequestration credits and also for reduction of N2O emissions that I'm not going to talk to you about the carbon credits, but I'm definitely going to show you today about the potential we can do and make a difference in reducing those N2O emissions. Okay. The other is there's a big push to find new ways of making fertilizer. Okay. Get away from the Haber-Bosch, which uses a lot of natural gas. And so one of the big things is actually going back to the very first means of producing fertilizer nitrogen. That was collecting liquid from a manure pile. The one that came after that was electricity. Okay, so the first industrial plant for making fertilizer was actually electricity from a hydro dam. I think it was in Norway. And so that was well decades before the Haber-Bosch process. So that's been revisited. I'm actually dealing with a company in Iceland that is using geothermal
to produce electricity from steam to produce a pilot scale fertilizer plant that can service about 500 acres a year in terms of producing the fertilizer for. So we're trying to get a pilot in Manitoba of that on our hydroelectricity that we have. The other is using organic sources of nitrogen, and that's a big component of regenerative agriculture, right? But that's not a clear solution, actually, and I'll show you that in a moment. So some of these are carrots, and some of them are sticks, right? The taxes are more of a club. And then there's lots of creativity. And that's the great thing about humans, is that they'll be creative in figuring out things. And so I'm always optimistic because of that. So this is an example of using organic sources. So there's very little information about organic production means and nitrous oxide emissions, that greenhouse gas. And so I had a graduate student that looked at this. We used Canada's oldest organic study, field crop study, to look at this, and we found that on the far left, there's emissions. You get those spikes. That is conventional wheat fertilized with urea, and it's producing N2O emissions after the planting, and then we got a rain. And the organic plots, of course, receive no fertilizer, so they're flatline. So that made sense. That's great. That's what we expected, right? We go through the growing season and see no N2O, and that's very typical. Unless we add nitrogen, we're not going to really see the N2O emissions. We go into the fall, still nothing. But we plowed down the alfalfa. The alfalfa was grown for 2 years and plowed down. That's where that arrow is going down. No emissions after that. Okay. Over the winter, next spring, it thaws. Our soils freeze. Thaws, no emissions. Okay. And then we go to 2015 and do the whole experiment again. And we get emissions again from the fertilizer that went in for spring wheat. Then we plowed down again. We plowed in late August, the alfalfa. And then it rained, and rained quite a bit. So the alfalfa started to break down very rapidly in our soil. And it mineralized, and it produced lots of nitrate. And then what ended up happening is, in the next spring, when the soil thawed, we got this huge plume of nitrous oxide emissions being emitted. Okay, and that really shocked us, because everybody said that, well, organic production produces way less N2O than using fertilizers. And then we said, oh, hang on here. It depends on the conditions. If it's wet, we're going to get actually much more N2O emissions, okay? So this is what I say, that organic sources are not a cure, whereas we're still pulsing with nitrogen the soil. And if we're going to get nitrogen moving to nitrate at some point, then we're going to get the N2O emissions, okay? So we can't just rely on going to organic sources. I think we have to rely on fertilizer sources for quite a while still to come for nitrogen nutrition. And this is where the optimistic stuff comes in, of the 4R nutrient management. Who's heard of 4Rs? Very good, excellent. So, okay, I guess I can go now, right? We don't have to do this. No. We'll look at the different components, and I'll show you some data. I wish I could show you a lot more data. The rate, and this is probably the most challenging component of 4Rs, okay? Because rate is often determined by what you want to do, it's not a great science behind determining the rate of nitrogen, and we tend to we tend to recommend nitrogen at a rate that is good for most fields, okay? So for most of those fields, it's actually an oversupply of nitrogen, because we don't want to leave some fields short of nitrogen, so the recommendations are actually kind of blanket and to reduce the risk of shorting nitrogen of our crops, okay? We're going to have to change that approach and go to a field-by-field basis, okay? And that that is still in its infancy in doing that. So I wish I could really show you work in that area, but not. But the bottom line here with rate is that if we're using for our management, we need to be thinking about adjusting our rates. So what happens, I think, is most people just do the same thing in terms of rates that they've done before. They've changed their practices, maybe bought some enhanced efficiency fertilizers, but haven't changed the rates. So I'm saying, let's think about changing those rates, okay? Other is source. Now, most of our sources are ammonium, based fertilizers like urea or anhydrous ammonia, probably still a little bit used in Ontario still. It's a big source for Manitoba still. And what's new are the enhanced efficiency fertilizers. I'm going to show you the results of some of the research with that, but that's what my breakout session talks are about specifically, which I get much more in depth. Okay, so we're just going to scratch the surface today on the enhanced efficiency fertilizers. Then there's placement, and this one I find fascinating because it actually has a lot of opportunity. And you come into play because you decide how to place the fertilizer. And of course, it's going to be highly dependent on your machinery and also the soil conditions in terms of wet, dry, what crop it is, like winter wheat or another crop that you can inject into or something like that. We're going to talk a bit about this, and the key thing here will be subsurface placement of nitrogen. And the last one is the timing, which you have a control of as well. So a key thing here is to provide the nitrogen to the crop as it needs it. That's easily said, more challenging to actually do effectively in the field, right? So let's go back to school a little bit about the nitrogen cycle. Here's our corn plant, and our corn plant is going to take up a dominantly nitrate from the soil. Like I was telling people in the breakout session, our crops are weeds, our annual crops are weeds, and weeds like nitrate as their nitrogen source. So it's really dependent on the nitrate, which is on the far right. So as we add fertilizer, the box on the top right, that goes into an ammonium form, and then bacteria in the soil will convert that over to nitrate. And then that's the majority of what our crops will be taking up. The problem is there is prone to loss, okay? The ones I want to really focus on is the nitrate leaching that can be lost, and especially here in Ontario, it can be very significant because you have excess water budget here, and especially in the fall after the crops have been taken off. So whatever residual nitrogen you have in the soil in terms of nitrate has the potential to be gone in your light and medium textured soils. Another is, because we're using these ammonium sources, urea sources, they can lead to the production of ammonia. And if that's near at the surface of the soil or on the surface of the soil, that can go up to the atmosphere. Ammonia is it loves to go into the atmosphere and become a gas, especially at high pH. So it's an issue, and this one actually is quite an economic loss. So nitrate is an economic loss too. Easily you can get 10, 20, 30 pounds of N loss per acre, maybe more. Craig Drury here probably has much better data on that. And also with ammonia losses as well, Craig has some great data on ammonia volatilization in the Southwest here. And the other losses are the nitrous oxide N2O. Now, this isn't a loss that's going to hurt you in the bank at all, because it's just a kilogram or two of, or a pound or two of N2O nitrogen, but it is a potent greenhouse gas. So even a little bit goes a long way to having a significant impact on the environment. And the other is denitrification, which can lead to N2O, but mostly leads to another gas, the gas that we're mostly breathing in right now, nitrogen gas. That one can be an economic issue for you in terms of losing tens of pounds of nitrogen from your nitrate, especially in your heavier textured soils with high organic matter that can be prone to waterlogging. So we're going to look at the four R's and see yields, So a big thing that people say always is, well, I don't want to reduce my yields if I'm changing practices, and then also they'd like to see actually an increase in yield, if anything. So that's what we're going to be looking at in particular. Now, on the source side of things, you have various new options for fertilizers. Some people call these more smart fertilizers, high-tech fertilizers. From my standpoint, these are still very low-tech. In the pipeline are much more advanced technologies that we haven't quite seen yet. A lot of nanotechnology-type approaches. But there's three various options for sources. This is, I mean, in terms of formulations for urea-type products. Urease inhibitors, addition of urease inhibitors to prevent ammonia emissions, losses. And the poster child of that is agritane from Coke. And then nitrification inhibitors, which slow down the appearance of nitrate from our fertilizers. And various products are out there. Some of them are very old, some of them more new. And then there are products that have both of those together. Call those double inhibitors. And Super U is the most well-known of the double inhibitor products that's available that you can get from your retailers. Then the last one is ESN, or the polymer-coated ureas, which have a very thin plastic coating around the urea molecule that meters out the urea based on temperature and moisture of the soil. Okay, and these are can quite delay the nitrogen appearance by 3 to 6 weeks, even more maybe in very dry soil conditions. Okay. So let's look at some data here in terms of different sources, different placement techniques here. And this is grain corn, actually Ridgetown College, a project in collaboration with Dave Hooker, University of Guelph. And just looking at dribble addition in season, shallow side dress and deep side dress injections of UAN. And there's the nitrogen, the corn response to the different N application rates. And you can see that in this case, the dribble, which is completely on the surface, had the lowest yield. And so likely there's something wrong in terms of we're losing nitrogen from just the surface application of the UAN. The shallow side dress, higher yields, as did the deep side dress, and maybe there's a difference in terms of most economical rate being a little bit better with the shallow in terms of lower nitrogen to obtain the profitable yields. So how we place these fertilizers is quite important. And here's an example of urea, conventional granular urea, ESN, which is a polymer-coated urea, and Super U, which is a double inhibitor. And this is grain corn yield again. These are pre-plant treatments that have been incorporated. And you can see the ESN is lower, that's the dashed line, than the Super U or conventional urea. This is one of my studies in Manitoba. It's part of the same project with Dave and Joanne Whalen from McGill University. And so what's happening here is that ESN is lower, and we do see this because it does slowly release the nitrogen. But I've done here is added 100% ESN in our treatments, when we shouldn't be doing that. If we're using the ESN, you're going to want to use a blend of that product. So you can use conventional urea that can provide a quick shot of nitrogen, and then have the ESN carry through with a prolonged or sustained nitrogen addition, okay? So, and usually the ratio is something like 3-1, something like that, of ESN to conventional urea, okay? So I'm pointing this out because some of these products, we have to use them very carefully to make sure that they are still going to be providing the nitrogen that our crops will need. And here's an example from Craig's work published on grain corn yield with injection of UAN. This was on the Brookston clay loam at Woodsley. 2 years, 2013, 2014. And the blue bar, which is the lowest bar for all three of those, is your conventional UAN. And then the gold bar in the middle, which is a little bit higher than the UAN, has the urease inhibitor. And then the light blue is double inhibited urea, having product, a nitrification inhibitor, DCD, and the product that's urease inhibitor that's in agrotain. So you can see, and this is an injected UAN, and there's seems to be the inhibited products have a benefit in terms of improving the grain yield. Okay, so you can see here are some examples of the formulation of the source and the placement impacting the corn yields. Now let's look at the nitrous oxide, that potent greenhouse gas that I was talking about. And this is a summary of eight study sites in Manitoba, and six in Manitoba and two in Saskatchewan. And the bottom line is where that red box is highlighting there, you can see the bars are lower than all the other bars. And the key thing here is that means there's less N2O emissions, actually. And there are different ways of reporting N2O emissions based on kilograms of N2O emitted or relative to grain yield or as a fraction of added fertilizer. Any way you look at it, it comes down that two products in particular with nitrification inhibitors, Super U, which has DCD, and Entrench, which has nitropyrin in it, same product as an NSERV, extremely effective in reducing N2O. And we have gazillion studies like this. Craig has a gazillion studies on this. If we get them all together, it's often about a 30-40% reduction in N2O, as long as it's not an extremely dry year, where there's no emissions at all, or very low emissions anyway. So this is phenomenal. So I started my work with N2O actually in 1990 with Eric Beauchamp at Guelph, and after finishing my master's and stuff, and then I went into with George Lazarevitz and plant pathology type related things, still with soils though. Then eventually when I went to Manitoba in 2002, I said, okay, I'm gonna start up this research again. I looked at what was happening and I said, well, damn it, not much has changed. And I was pretty bummed out in terms of didn't seem to be anything optimistic about being able to reduce N2O. But these products here are phenomenal. We can often get even a 50% reduction in N2O emissions, okay? So I really like these products, they're very effective. And the newer chemistries work better than the older products, okay? So it's really, really a very bright future for these products in terms of tackling the N2O issue. Okay, to continue with some of the 4 R's, in this case with placement, and this is looking at ammonia loss. So this is a summary of the literature done by colleagues in Quebec with Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada. And it's kind of a complicated graph, and I did some calculations so that we could kind of understand what was going on here with the summary. And basically, as those horizontal lines I put there, that's the depth of the placement of fertilizers, 1 inch, 1.5, 2.5, and 4. And as we go deeper in the soil, on the left side, we have less emissions, okay? So for example, at 2.5 inches, on average from these studies, is about 13% emissions of ammonia, as if we had just put the urea granules, left them on the surface of the soil, okay? So by going 2.5 lower, like in a band, we can reduce emissions by something like 87%, okay? But at 4 inches, you can see it goes down to zero, no emissions. So if you really want to save your nitrogen, go 4 inches and deeper, okay, with your injections. Who wants to do that? 4 inches is quite a bit, right? When I talk to my farmers in the prairies, 4 inches is crazy. That's almost the depth of our rooting zone. Not the rooting zone, but that's our tillage zone. Okay, we have very shallow operations out there, and to go 4 inches is pretty challenging. They'll go 3 inches, no problem, but four is challenging. But the bottom line here is go deeper, okay? Go deeper with your banding to reduce the risk of ammonia volatilization, okay? And the good thing is, even if you have a sand soil, if you're going down 4 inches, you pretty much, very much reduce that chance of the ammonia losses. And here's examples with nitrous oxide that we've done in Manitoba, and looking at urea, ESN, and Super U. So ESN, the polymer-coated, Super U, the double inhibitor, and then looking at incorporation versus side banding versus mid-row banding. We have a lot of mid-row banding in Manitoba where you skip every inter-row and you double the concentration of the nitrogen that you add in that every second inter-row, okay? And we can see that the emissions, this is the cumulative emissions over time that we measure during the growing season, and it's the urea incorporated had the most N2O, followed by the side banding, and then when we mid-row banded, even less N2O. The pattern is for two different soils. This is only 1 year I'm showing you, but there's more years that show similar results. And then when we use the enhanced efficiency fertilizer products like the ESN and the Super U, we can get even lower emissions. Okay, so cool thing is that we can stack these emission these tactics and get even lower emissions, like the enhanced efficiency and how we place the fertilizer. Here's another example from Manitoba of many studies that we've done, 5 studies, and that on the right in green are the Super U subsurface placed, and in the red is conventional urea shallow banded, so very close to the surface, about 3/4 of an inch banding. This is with canola. It's often done that shallow with canola in my neck of the woods. And you can see that by the shallow banding is problematic. Why? Because that zone where the transformations are occurring is close to the surface. And then N2O can escape much more readily to the surface, okay? So it's good to, even with the N2O, to go deeper. And the Super U is fantastic. Again, it just really clearly reduces the emissions. But look, you can go urea double deep banded. It's the bar in the middle. And that's pretty close to the Super U product line in terms of the emissions, okay? So just by controlling the placement, you can go a long way with reducing the emissions. And here's more work from that we've done in Manitoba looking at ammonia volatilization. And surface urea placed at the surface, you see the cumulative progress of volatilization losses, ammonia quick at the beginning and then it dies off. As Super U placed at the surface has quite a reduction early on, but then later on it seems to be creeping up, and I think it's because of the nitrification inhibitor in the Super U is causing a backup in the nitrogen cycle, causing the ammonia to still be present and can go off. So ideally, this year was dry, but in a wet year, should have mobilized that Super U into the soil deep enough that we wouldn't have gotten any more volatilization. So we do have to be careful. There's a lot of interest in using these products and just using them as a broadcast. But my point to you is, well, be careful. You can still be losing nitrogens, particularly in years that you don't get enough rain to soak it into the ground. But look at the shallow and deep band placements of conventional urea or Super U, very low emissions. And the deep band there is as if we put no fertilizer on that soil, and that's at 3 inches in terms of losses, okay? I love the management ones where you can just place and then have the reduce your emissions. So here's with UAN on corn in season dressings. And the most emissions of ammonia is by UAN top dress, so dribbled, and then shallow side dress and deep side dress are lower, with deeper being better than the shallow side dress. Okay, so you still have, with liquids, also have the ability to control your injection depth. And Craig right now is looking at the number of injection slots, actually, relative to the corn row, to see if doing two versus one can even change this and bring it even lower. But oftentimes, when we look at yield, we see no difference a lot with these treatments. And I think the reason was where I started off talking to you about the fact that we use our nitrogen rates to be broad-based for everybody. And that means that it's going to be much higher for most fields, okay, the nitrogen rates. So what I did in one study was we shorted the nitrogen for canola. We only put 70% of the recommended. And then we could spot a difference in blue of the broadcast left at the surface for urea, lower yielding than the red and the green, which were subsurface banding, and a bit of a trend for higher yield with a deeper banding. And that's only because we shorted the canola, okay? I don't recommend you shorting your canola this drastically. Sorry, your crops. Probably don't grow much canola. This is for research purposes. And then when we actually put the recommended nitrogen based on soil test, you get this. They're the same yields. And again, it's because what we lost with the surface application didn't matter, because we already had way more nitrogen than we needed for the canola. Okay? Makes sense. So you have to ask yourself, okay, well, should I be putting more nitrogen on, let it blow off, I'll just pay for that, or can I reduce my rates, save that money, okay? So that's, and you're going to be making those more and more of those questions, okay? Looking at the rate here, like I said, the most challenging one, okay? Soil testing's been traditionally to predict, but even that only goes so far. And this is an example from corn in Manitoba. If we look at the yield versus most economical rate spread, We're looking for yields in terms of the responses of a variation of about 80 bushels. And then for most economical rate, it's about 125 pounds of N per acre in terms of the spread based on these various fields here. That is a problem. If your field is the light blue one and your neighbor's the yellow one on the top, you're in a different ball game. Right? So this is a problem, and it's a serious problem, and we need to really tackle this and get to site-specific to be able to, so you can fine-tune. And the problem is that when we're changing these placements and timing and sources, we need to be changing the rate. If you're losing less, that means you maybe don't have to put on as much nitrogen, right? For the timing, just an example, in my neck of the woods, fall application is still very common. About one-third of all nitrogen is applied in the fall. And but with these products like Super U and various things, there's a bit of a push to say, hey, you know, your nitrogen will be protected. Just put it on the surface in the fall. Don't worry about it. So we tried that, and that was a big problem, okay? This is conventional urea, Super U, whatever, various enhanced products, didn't matter. We lost nitrogen, period, because of the snow melt and so forth. So, and you can see this is pretty serious yield reduction in canola. And we could even see a difference in different studies, summary of many studies looking at protein of hard red spring, and much lower protein with fall. The yields were the same, but we saw a protein difference, of course, and you know, in terms of nitrogen availability is really critical, and sulfur for your protein levels. So sometimes you don't have to see a yield difference, we can see a quality difference by these 4R practices as well. So keep that in mind. All right, Mike, can we go to web page? So I need you to take out your phones, and we're going to try to see if we can get through this real fast. I'm going to ask you some questions. So your smartphone, any moment now. You need to go to menti.com. Menti.com. M-E-N-T-I. .com. Menti.com. And you can start answering the first questions. It'll appear on your phone, the different options. It'll be much clearer to read than up here. And then we'll see the number of respondents in the bottom right. Okay, so menti.com, M-E-N-T.com. Your responses are not, I don't know who did the responses. It's all completely anonymous, okay? I'm saying I don't know, but, you know, maybe the government of China might know exactly what you're responding, okay? So what best describes you? A farmer, a consultant, somebody that supports farmers, or an academic? So how many people are in the room here, do you think? What's your registration? Anybody know the registration? No? Number? No? 300, wow, good. Yeah, we're gonna wait till 100, then I'll go. You can keep answering, because it'll still keep collecting them. Oh, what happened there? Oh. Mike, I think you're gonna have to do the shoulder results. Okay, most of you are farmers. You probably knew that. Okay. Humans have increased. Oh, shoot. Which one do we have going there, Mike? The IOF? Or CAP? I don't know, probably top left somewhere. IOF? Okay. Humans have increased the concentration of greenhouse gases, resulting in global warming. Do you strongly agree, disagree? Oh, it's coming in fast and furious now. Oh, yeah, keep it coming. Okay, Mike. All right, so we're skewed to the left there. Okay, skewed to the left, okay? That's interesting. I think over time it does get a little bit more skewed to the left to acknowledging that. Next one, I'll do it, Mike. I have changed, no, this is, oh, shoot, this is the wrong one. Okay, we're gonna pass this one. You wanna do it? Okay, if you do it, you're gonna do the same one that my Manitoba farmers have done. Okay. I have changed my management practices in the recent past to build more organic matter. This is good. Yeah. You guys. Okay, Mike? Wow. That's good. I will change in the near future my management to increase soil organic matter. So even if you have changed in the past, you're going to continue to do something different, you think, in the near future. You guys are pretty fast on these ones with organic matter. That's good. Mike? Wow. So I presume those two holdouts are probably non-farmers. You should be paid. You should be paid for increasing your organic matter. This is a hot one for our prairie guys. They're actually livid about this one. Pardon? Oh yeah, there's that. They want Justin to fork over more of a check. Oh yeah. Yeah. Okay, Mike. Oh wow, look at that. Excellent. Good. I use 4R nutrient management and using nitrogen on my farm. No, it's a yes or no. It's like being pregnant or not. Okay, Mike? Okay, good. So I'm presuming the other 32 are using 5 or 6R, right? Yeah, good. I manage my nitrogen additions to reduce nitrous oxide emissions. You have to be thinking about nitrous oxide, okay, when you make your choices. Okay, Mike, you can keep answering while we show them. I have a lot of work to do. I have to come back. I'm from Ontario, actually, so I just need to come back home more often, huh? So I manage my nitrogen additions to reduce ammonia loss. Now we'll see how well Craig has got the message out to you guys. Okay, Mike? Excellent. I manage my nitrogen additions to reduce leaching. Now, if you're on some heavy soil, then you may not, but... Okay, Mike? Yeah. Wow, look at that. That's astounding. That's the highest one. Of those major losses or important environmental, this is the one that wins out. It's getting bigger, too. Look at that. My nitrogen management and rates are exactly the same for each of my fields. So assume, let's say, you're growing corn on several different fields or winter wheat and stuff like that. Do you manage the fields individually, making your decisions, or do you just say, okay, I'm going to put 160, 180 on all my corn? Okay? Okay, Mike? This is what I was expecting. We got a lot of work to do. Need to find out why. Why? Is it a lot more work? Oh, so hang on a second. Oh, am I going... Yes. That's right. Sorry. Yeah. I understood that. Now, I won't respond with what I want to do back to you. iSoil test for nitrogen to determine fertilizer additions. Do you use nitrate tests? A pre-side dress or at plant? Always, never, every 2 years, every three or more. I'm curious about this one. Oh, oops. Mike? You're not from Canmore, are you, Mike? Mike, can you click that sucker? Thank you. Always, never, every 2 years. Okay, interesting. Okay. I know there, you know, in a what, where you have, we have lots of water and movement of nitrogen via leaching, it can really affect the utility of tests. So just curious to see how we can improve this and get some other tools out there for you, like, using drones or handheld sensors, canopy testers, sensors and stuff like that. My nitrogen fertilizer is placed subsurface. The percent of times that you do applications, okay, 0, a quarter, half, 3/4 of the time, or 100%. 100% would mean you're always subsurface. Broadcast Incorporated is subsurface. Mike?
Okay, interesting. So we got a bit of a little bit skewed to the right there. Okay, good. I don't expect, well, you should always have some not subsurface because of your crops or situations. I have moved from subsurface placed nitrogen fertilizer to leaving it on the surface. I've thrown this one in because in the prairies, we're seeing a trend of going away from subsurface to getting custom applicators coming in and floating fertilizer on, and then not followed by incorporation. So I'm kind of curious, what's the scenario here? Okay, Mike? Good? I use enhanced efficiency nitrogen fertilizers. Percent of my nitrogen applied. Zero, quarter, 50, 75, or 100. 100 means you're always using something like Super U or ESN or Agritain. Oh, Mike? Oh, there we go. Okay, so we have some adopters. It's quite a bit, actually. I nitrogen audit my soil. In other words, you look at your nitrates in the soil at harvest, or you do a nitrogen stock test on your corn. Why I'm asking this question is because I'm curious to know if you're actually checking, doing an audit of how good of a nitrogen manager you are in terms of not having gobs of nitrogen left over as nitrates. Okay. Okay, Mike. Okay, 18. Sometimes, good. Excellent, I think that's a useful tool. It's costly and it's labor, and when timing, you probably don't want to be doing it, but it's a good check to see if you're leaving behind lots of pounds in the soil, okay? It's also good to do some soil tests in the fall and repeat it in the springtime to see how much nitrogen you've lost over the winter, too. I would say urge you to do that. I believe agriculture must reduce its emissions of N2O. Strongly agree to strongly disagree. I see you. I don't think there's too many more. Mike? Okay. Farmers, producers should be paid for reducing N2O. I think I'm going to cut it off at this one with just one more question, and that's it. Mike? Okay, good. All right, now, that's a really good question. Hang on. Okay, do this one. How much are you willing to pay more for your fertilizer nitrogen bill? 0.5, so forth, to reduce N2O by half. Yeah, you're pretty slow answering this one. Yeah. It depends, right? Okay, Mike. Wow, that's awesome, guys. Give two words that come first to mind when you think about for our nitrogen nutrient management. This is the last one. Two words. First thing that comes to your mind about for our nutrient management, okay? You can't use bad words. There's a filter, okay? Oh, God, you guys are slow on this one. Really slow. It's just two words, people. First thing that comes to mind. Okay, Mike. Responsible, smart, efficient, sustainable, profitable, stewardship. Very good words. Okay, keep that in. Thank you very much. We won't take any questions. This is your participation part. Thank you.